Are you ready for a film and a show that have just been dropped on Netflix and are creating quite the waves? पहला है एक स्पैनिश क्राइम शो आचे और दूसरी है एक घंटे 48 मिनट की फिल्म द अर्थक्वेक बर्ड जो मेरा नेटफ्लिक्स अकाउंट मुझे कई बार याद दिला चुका है 75 नोटिफिकेशन देके कि देख लो मैं क्या देख ही लो यार मैंने कहा आहो सबसे पहले स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम द स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द कंट्री ऑफ ल तोमातीना ट्रेलर देखिए ट्रेलर जिंदगी मिलेगी ना दोबारा का नहीं आचे का
¿Trabajas en ese club?
El Albatros. ¿Tiene algún problema?
Tú no eres uno de ellos.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Elena. Elena con H. ¿Dónde sacáis tanto dinero?
Olvídalo todo. Esta es tu nueva vida.
¿Por qué me has elegido a mí?
Apareciste aquí, ya no te acuerdas. Quizá fuiste tú quien me eligió a mí. ¿Qué quieres?
Quiero saberlo todo.
Está subiendo muy deprisa.
Unos suben. Otros bajan.
No vamos a permitir que utilicen Barcelona como puerta de entrada para la heroína.
¿Por qué sigues con él? Tú tienes una hija.
¿Parece mal que quiera protegerla?
¿Tú no te das cuenta de que vamos a acabar todos muertos?
Eres dura, pero un día se te acabará la suerte. ¿Tú qué te crees? ¿Que soy la misma que tronó el albatros? ¿Dónde está? He aprendido que puedo conseguir todo lo que quiera.
ट्रेलर भले ही छोटा है पर छोटा पैकेट बड़ा धमाका इज व्हाट परफेक्टली सम्स इट अप जस्ट अबाउट इनफ टीज फॉर एवरीथिंग द लव सस्पेंस ड्रामा एंड जस्ट अबाउट इनफ इंट्रीग टू वांट टू बिंज ऑल द 8 एपिसोड्स इन वन गो स्प्लिट अक्रॉस 8 एपिसोड्स एंड ट्रिपिंग इन एस्थेटिक स्प्लेंडर आचे कंबाइंस अ वेल रिटन कैरेक्टर ड्रिवन स्टोरी विद सम नाइसली प्लेस्ड मेलो ड्रामा अक्रॉस इट्स रन टाइम Boasting an eccentric soundtrack and some really impressive set design, Hache lives and breathes 1960s Barcelona, delivering a decent crime offering, even if it fails to really ignite the genre as much as it perhaps should. At the heart of this one lies empathetic mother Helena, who finds herself in desperate need of cash and influence to free her husband from jail. Between looking after her daughter and scraping a living to survive, Helena is forced into a difficult situation. As she seduces dangerous drug lord Malpica in order to raise funds to free her husband from prison. After the opening episode, used to set the scene and introduce the character, the rest of the series see the story split into two distinctive narratives. The first sees Elena operating under the alias of Hache, attempt to gain Malpica's trust as she works in his organization while Inspector Vinsua investigates several murders in the second. These do tie in together though and don't always work disparately, which is good. All of this builds up to a dramatic finale that sees Malpica and Hache go head to head, ending with a suitable conclusion to this tale. Along the way, there's plenty of melodrama and twist in the tale, and for the most part, the series does well to keep things ticking along at a decent pace. One of the standout elements of Hache happens to be the musical score. There's some great jazz instrumentals throughout the episodes and juxtaposed against this are more sombre, heartfelt vocal tracks that breathe life into Barcelona during this time period. There's a distinct lack of anachronisms here too, which is testament to the excellent work done with the both costume and the set design. Props to Adriana here though, because although the story doesn't always shine as much as it perhaps should, she absolutely does. The torn inner conflict between her undercover operation and Malpica works perfectly against her devotion to her husband. It's a simple setup, but one that's acted really well throughout the series. It's easy to empathize with her too, and right from the off, Hache wants really no time to be wasted bringing you on board to her way of thinking. It's worth noting that the dubbing here is truly awful. There's an option for British English, and aside from the jarring, sickly contrast of Spain in 1960 with upper-class British voices, entire sentences are changed and reworded, with colloquialisms and exaggerated sentences losing the ebb and flow of the natural Spanish dialect. If you do intend to watch this one, I absolutely implore you, as always, not to watch the dubbed version, guys. Hache may not be the best Spanish original on Netflix, but it is another solid offering nonetheless. The set design is good, like I said, the plot progresses at a decent pace, and Elena herself is the perfect protagonist for this tale. While some of the supporting characters don't always shine, there's enough intrigue with this one to see you through to the climactic finish. Decider ka manna hai ki created by Veronica Fernandez, Hache is a show that doesn't try to do too much at one time. I kind of agree with them. We've got Elena's side of the story and the players involved, Malpica's side of the story and the players involved there too, and clear motivations for why each is doing what they are doing. Now, combined with this is fine acting and tight pacing from the director, George, you have the makings of a series that is one of the more engaging ones Netflix has produced this year. The show is determined to present Helena as a strong woman who's doing what she's doing not because she's a victim, but that she's taking charge of a situation. Ugarte is a force to be reckoned with in the first episode, exuding a powerful and sexy manner that shows that Helena will never be anything but in charge. She right away establishes Helena as something other than your garden variety hooker in 60s Barcelona. And her determination to go back to Malpica not just for his money, but the intrigue he brings to her life is evident in Ugarte's performance. Ray also does a fine job as Malpica with just the right combination of pain and power coursing through his veins, as well as providing his character with just the right limb to convey his barely hidden pain. For now, Norisia's Inspector Vanessa is the typical cop who doesn't know what this town is about. Role, things will change as he gets the job to lead the city's first drug brigade. And finally, mera manna to ye hai ki yaar stream kar lo. Two fine lead performances and a well-paced first episode make Hache a very promising show. You probably don't want to miss this, huh? Time for a short break. Don't go anywhere. I will be back with Earthquake Bird. Hi guys, welcome back to HopCorn. आज मैं आपको कन्विंस कर रही हूँ टू वॉच स्पैनिश क्राइम शो आचे और दूसरी है 1 hour 48 minutes की फिल्म द अर्थक्वेक बर्ड. जिससे पहले हम अर्थक्वेक बर्ड की गहराइयों में जाएं, लेट्स टेक अ लुक एट इट्स ट्रेलर.
We have a few questions.
Okay.
Where were you the night Lily Bridges disappeared?
Lucy, this is Lily Lucy Flower.
So how long have you been in Japan?
3 weeks now.
It's weird how everyone stares at you. It's like being famous.
Some people get addicted to that.
You are not normal.
Neither are you.
No. So let's not pretend to be.
You photograph everything.
Of course.
Do you have a boyfriend?
I do.
He's so cute.
Cute. Okay, whatever. He's gorgeous. He's like obsessed with you.
Why do you say that?
I know, man.
She's a piece of work, that one. It's like you're the only one who exists. Then she moves on to someone else, and it's like you were never even there.
What do you say about the future? Come on.
We have something no one else could share. Don't you know that?
I do.
Something wrong?
I know what I'm feeling.
And it's not right at all.
You must trust me.
You're the only person who ever really saw who I was.
I feel like something really bad's gonna happen.
It's weird how people stare at you in Japan, observes Lily Bridges, played by Riley, mere days into the buoyant and outgoing American's new life in late 80s Tokyo. It's like being famous. Lily, a former nurse with a fondness for dancing and reading palms, doesn't seem especially worked up about being noticed like that. About being made so aware of her own visibility, but her experience speaks to a broader phenomenon that Western cinema has documented for decades. Japan has become the de facto backdrop for movies about white people feeling conditionally and often therapeutically othered. From Tokyo Fiancé to Tokyo Drift, the land of the rising sun is often depicted as a place where certain types of ganjin can step outside of themselves in comfort. Where Scarlett Johansson can safely take stock of her own dislocation on a day trip to Kyoto, Tom Cruise can atone for his war crimes by killing some more of his countrymen, and James Bond can fake his own death and be reborn through the magical powers of Yellowface. Many of these films, some more problematically than others, rely on Japan's legible foreignness to create a clarifying distance between their characters and the world around them. And the best of them tend to redirect that foreignness back on the people who first projected it. While too muddled and morose to hold together as a psychosexual thriller, Wash Westmoreland's Earthquake Bird can be compelling for how it both explores and subverts the idea that everyone gets a little bit lost in translation. Lucy Fly, played by Alicia, beguilingly channeling Isabel Rupert, is first seen in the middle of a crowded Tokyo subway train, where she stands out like a dead pixel. But this dour young expat isn't quite as out of place as she first seems. She's lived in Japan for more than 5 years, and she speaks the language fluently enough to be employed as a translator. We see her working on the subtitles for Ridley Scott's Black Rain, a fun nod to this film's producer. And when Lucy is hauled into a police station and questioned about the whereabouts of a missing American friend, she warns the detectives to be careful. I understand everything. Yes and no. So begins a story that unfolds in reverse from how these things usually do. As someone who already feels at home on the other side of the world starts to be destabilized when a stranger sees right through her. His name is Teiji, played by Naoki, strong in his first English-speaking role. And he's a photographer who lives in a studio behind the noodle restaurant where he works. He's also the kind of guy who tells women that he loves them for their scars, and he talks to Lucy like she's a tourist looking for a story to bring home as a souvenir. His transparent attempts at flattery include bon mots such as, "The first time we saw each other, I knew we could be truthful." When an earthquake interrupts their first night together, Teiji instructs Lucy to listen to the chirps that reverberate through the city after it stops shaking. There's a metaphor there. But much like the city is not a timeline, it isn't worth the energy it would take to untangle. The severe and introverted Lucy is forced into an awkward roommate situation with Lily, who feels like she could have walked straight out of a John Hughes movie, and we know that Lucy will eventually be the prime suspect in her Lily's death. The thrust of the story involves puzzling out how Teiji fits into all this. How these three attractive misfits graduate from the innocence of a group karaoke night to a dangerous and erotically charged trip to Sado Island. But Westmoreland, as both writer and director, is less interested in plot than he is in passing the space between who the characters really are and how Lucy thinks of them. The most compelling scenes are the ones that trouble the water instead of charting a course through it. Lucy dresses in a kimono and plays in a string quartet with three Japanese women. She travels to Mount Fuji with a camera. She has a strange encounter with Lily in the middle of a bumpy night. Some of these moments challenge what we think of her, while others challenge what she thinks of others. The rift between everyone grows wider with every minute. We all live in our own reality, a detective observes. And when Teiji sees someone like Lily walking through the streets of Shibuya, he knows that her reality is tantalizingly far removed from the one he can see through the lens of his camera. It turns out her truth is a lot darker than we might have anticipated. Lucy thinks that death is following her, and she might have just a point too. It seems she didn't go to Japan to find herself, but rather to flee who she was, and her first encounters with Teiji are so involving because he is able to see her for who she is without being able to grasp what made her that way. Watching Kendra try to keep it a comfortable remove and deny Lucy from confronting her own demons is the movie's greatest pleasure, especially when the person she was and the person she fought to become are intertwined together in a lengthy monologue that Kendra delivers in flawless but obviously foreign Japanese. In the rare moments when Earthquake Bird trembles with purpose, everything about it becomes easier to appreciate. For example, Chung Sung-hoon's lush cinematography and Atticus Ross's ominously propulsive score. But it is disconcerting how often Earthquake Bird begs you to compare it to Loki Haruki Murakami, only to steer things back towards the stuff of a more conventional thriller whenever the mystery of it goes too abstract. Moribund, where still Alice was moving, and restrained from Colette was bursting at the seams. Westmoreland Key Earthquake Bird is every bit as elusive on the screen as Susanna John's novel of the same name was on the page. It's nice at times, you know, and seductive enough, but then it runs out of steam. Without depth and detail of Jones' prose too, much of the movie is lost in the same in-between that Lucy is trying to chart for herself. Lucy might fly halfway around the planet to forget who she is, but Earthquake Bird leaves us precious little reason to remember who she became. Although you guys have become quite the avid viewers, huh? Chalo, time to take a chotu break. Gaane ke piche kya hai? Nahi dekhna? वेलकम टू गाने के पीछे क्या है। बाला 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 ऑलरेडी परेशान हो गए ना हाउसफुल 4 के इस गाने को लूप पर सुन सुन के दिस वेडिंग सीजन। हाँ, हॉपकॉर्न नाउ ब्रिंग्स यू एक्चुअल फिल्म बाला स्टारिंग आयुष्मान खुराना का सॉन्ग प्यार तो था, जिसमें आयुष्मान की टूटे दिल के कारण बनी है उनकी ऑन स्क्रीन वाइफ एंड विकी डोनर को स्टार यामी गौतम। फिल्म में यह हार्ट ब्रेकिंग सॉन्ग तब आता है जब हो जाता है द डिपार्चर ऑफ बाला शुक्ला की न्यू ब्राइड का आफ्टर शी डिस्कवर्स दैट ही वेयर्स अ विग। जी हाँ, नो प्राइजेस फॉर गेसिंग द फिल्म इज एसेंशियली ऑन द इशू ऑफ बोल्डिंग। द इमोशनल नंबर टचेज अपॉन द इमोशंस ऑफ आयुष्मान्स कैरेक्टर हु इज ग्रीविंग द लॉस ऑफ हिज लव। द स्लो सॉन्ग शोज हाउ द टू फॉल इन लव, गेट मैरिड एंड ड्रिफ्ट अपार्ट व्हेन यामी रियलाइजेस दैट ही वाज हाइडिंग बिहाइंड अ विग। He is seen wearing a wig as he woos her and comes to marry her. The song later shares a glimpse of how he finally becomes friends with a dark-skinned girl played by Bhumi Pednekar. The song has been composed by Sachin Jigar, sung by Jubin Nautiyal in a C-score and penned by Priya Saraiya. The film is now showing at theatres near you. Dekh ke aa jao. After all, Aishman ki film hai. And tell us what you feel in the comments below. For more updates, stay tuned to HopCorn. This is Meen Bhavya.